वेलकम टू द सेकेंड राउंड टेबल सेशन ऑफ मिड डे फॉर मुंबई. दिस इज प्रूथा भोसले, जर्नलिस्ट विद मिड डे. अ न्यूज़पेपर बॉर्न फ्रॉम एंड कमिटेड टू द सिटी लॉन्च्ड मिड डे फॉर मुंबई 3 months अगो. एट मिड डे आवर जर्नलिस्ट रिपोर्ट एक्सक्लूसिव स्टोरीज एंड लॉन्ग इन्वेस्टिगेटिव सीरीज ऑन इम्पॉर्टेंट इशूज, हेल्पिंग टू फाइंड आंसर्स फॉर द पब्लिक. विद मिड डे फॉर मुंबई वी एम टू होल्ड राउंड टेबल डिस्कशंस विद एक्सपर्ट्स लाइक वी आर गोइंग टू बी डूइंग टुडे by collaborating with governing authorities as well as scientific experts to action on ground impact. Midday for Mumbai is an effort to bring about change for the better through ideas and debates. Our today's topic is the third wave challenge to Mumbai's pediatric healthcare. Experts are forewarning against the third wave of COVID-19 hitting India as early as August or September, with many fearing that it could hit children disproportionately. The common explanation is that since many adults would have had the disease or the COVID vaccine by then, in comparison, children would be a susceptible population. In the second wave, there was a rise in the number of post-COVID complications in children, including multisystem inflammatory syndrome. We also know it as MISC. The concern is coupled with lack of easily accessible resources, such as a list of children's hospitals, ambulances, pediatric staff, ventilators, oxygen cylinders, and helpline numbers, leaving the adult and the parent population worried and restless. Also, let's not forget the fact that this is the unvaccinated age group, making it more vulnerable to the virus. With experts divided on whether the next COVID wave will endanger kids, is city's health infrastructure ready to face the worst? It is through today's session that we try to find answers to the public's concerns. Let's begin this session by introducing all our panelists. We have today with us Mr. Amit Deshmukh, who is the Maharashtra Medical Education Minister. In December 2019, he took oath as a cabinet minister in the 2019 Maharashtra Legislative Assembly. The son of former Maharashtra Chief Minister Vilas Rao Deshmukh, Amit is an MLA from Latur. Thank you for joining us today. Our next panelist is Mr. Suresh Kakani, who is the Additional Municipal Commissioner. Kakani, a 2004 batch IAS officer, was previously the Managing Director of the Maharashtra Airport Development Corporation. Thank you for joining the panel today, sir. Next on the panel is Dr. T. Jacob John, who is a world-renowned pediatrician and virologist. He established India's first diagnostic virology lab and conducted pioneering research on infectious diseases, clinical virology, and epidemiology. His model of polio control in Vellore and North Akko district became the forerunner of global polio eradication. Currently, he is co-chair India Expert Advisory Group on Measles and Rubella Elimination. Welcome, sir. We also have with us Dr. Subhash Hira, who is an active invitee on the WHO Geneva COVID Review Forums. His expertise in controlling the Ebola pandemic in West Africa in 2014 was well appreciated by the United Nations. He has also actively worked for 40 years on HIV/AIDS, tuberculosis, and other infectious diseases, and was health advisor to the government of India and African countries. Welcome to the panel, sir. Next we have is Dr. Shakuntala Prabhu, who is a medical director of B.J. Wadia Hospital for Children. She's professor and also heads the pediatric cardiology and department of pediatrics at the Wadia Hospital. Welcome, ma'am. We also have with us Mr. Janmeet Singh. Janmeet is a successful business development professional. He is a well-known name in the fintech and startup space. He's based out of Mumbai and stays with his wife and a six-year-old daughter. He would be sharing a parent's concern on this panel today. And we have Mr. Vinod Kumar Menon, editor of Special Investigations for Midday. He is the winner of Ramnath Goenka Journalism Award and Reading Award for Excellence in Journalism. Also, Ms. Pal, who is the special correspondent for Midday. Pal has 15 years of experience in journalism. She has been covering health stories since 2010. A quick note before we start the discussion today. Each panelist will get about 5 to 6 minutes to answer each question. Mr. Kakani and Mr. Deshmukh would be taking questions from other panelists before exiting this session an hour from now. Let's begin with our discussion today then. My first question is for you, Mr. Janmeet Singh. Janmeet, lack of medical information is what usually comes in the way of a parent trying to get help for a sick kid in the pandemic, right? You found yourself in the dark when it was detected after multiple tests that your 6-year-old daughter had developed multi-system inflammatory syndrome, a serious condition linked with COVID-19, where different parts of the body can get inflamed. What are the initial roadblocks you faced in finding the right treatment for her? And why do you feel now that the government hasn't amplified information linked to COVID for the public to get the required help in the right time?
Firstly, thank you so much, Pratha, for giving me a platform to voice myself. And it's an absolute honor that I'm speaking in front of such eminent people. My struggle with COVID was in two parts. One, when me, my wife, and my daughter had COVID, and we had to deal with it. While that part was pretty smooth, to be very honest, if I put it across very bluntly. Unfortunately, when we recovered, and like on, I remember 16th of April was the date when the BMC seal of our flat was opened up, and we were absolutely rejoiced that, the worst is over now. At least we knew that there is a lot to come ahead. Just after 2 days, my daughter suddenly started having fever, and at that point of time we really didn't anticipate that there is something like a post-COVID complication. So on the 20th of April itself, we got her admitted. By 21st, other tests came, and we were horrified to see the medical parameters, and we were told that your kid is suffering from something which is MISC, as you rightly said. Now the worrisome thing which we really realized was this is something which, if it actually goes out to a proportion, that can be even fatal, because because of that, as a layman, what we were made to understand that if the inflammation actually moves out of control, it can even lead to a cardiac arrest or a organ failure, and we were literally horrified. That was one. So that's an absolute lack of awareness which we really had. Might be if we would have known it earlier, we would have then on the first day itself we would have got her admitted and the treatment could have started. That happened. We waited for another 24 hours. The results, the tests were done. When the results came, it were even further horrifying, because all the parameters had, deteriorated post that. The doctors acted fast, and, they took calls and they started steroid treatment. And fortunately, the steroid treatment worked for her. That is something which I feel that there's something, there's a lack of awareness which is still there in the society and which needs to spread.
Thank you, Janmi. Thank you for sharing your story with us. Before we move to the next question, Mr. Kakani would like to show a short presentation.
I'm Suresh Kakani. I'm Additional Municipal Commissioner, Western Sabha, looking after the health portfolio along with other subjects. Thanks, Midday, for inviting me and for sharing the preparedness for the third wave. So as you know, Mumbai is a densely populated city, having a population density approximately 20,000 persons per square kilometer. Another problem we have is a floating population. Close to 60 lakh people are traveling to Mumbai every day, either for the work or for some other related activities. Probably Municipal Corporation, Mumbai Municipal Corporation, may be the only organization or the urban local body having the strong primary healthcare, secondary and the tertiary healthcare. Primary healthcare, as you know, we have more than 200 health posts, 175 dispensaries, 28 maternity homes. In the secondary also, we have 16 peripheral hospitals and 5 specialty hospitals. And as I said, maybe only Municipal Corporation having 5 medical colleges, 4 general medical colleges and 1 dental medical college. And this infrastructure is hugely supported by the private sector. The presence of private sector is also very large, and that is also work very well along with the Municipal Corporation. So far as the COVID is concerned, if you look at the graph, the first peak reached, the blue line shows the cases, the red line shows the death rate, or the CFR. The first peak, the blue line shows the first peak reached in the month of April, and it was around 2,800 plus cases. And the second peak we experienced in the month of April again. The reduction of CFR or the death rate, it is because of the various interventions or the innovations on the part of Municipal Corporation. We have adopted a patient-centric approach. In the sense, Mission Universal, we have launched various programs like Mission Universal Testing. Though it is a mission universal testing, but we resorted to the targeted testing, because if we go ahead with the targeted testing, we try to get more number of positive patients so that further spread can be checked, chase the virus, by resorting the contact tracing. Normally, 1:5 should be the ratio for one person. 15 contact tracing should be taken out, and that we have applied. 4T strategy: tracing, tracking, testing, and treating. These we have adopted, and that is also worked very well in our favor. During the first wave, the patient used to chase initial months. I mean, in the month of March or April, the patient used to chase us for getting bed or for getting admission in the hospital. But during the second phase of the first wave and the second wave, we used to chase the patient about, suppose the patient is symptomatic, whether he would like to get admitted in the private hospital or the public hospital. And the facilitation was really smooth. And this also helped us to build the confidence among the citizens. So the overall panic level has gone down considerably. And this is possible only because of the decentralized bed allotment system, which we have here in Mumbai by opening 24 ward war rooms, because Mumbai traditionally is divided into 24 wards. And in all the 24 wards, we set up war rooms to look after the positive patients of the particular ward, to facilitate their admission, to keep track on the patient about their health status, and to refer that patient in case of need. Initially, the death rate was very high. It was around 5.8% in the month of May and June. But when we launched the Mission Save Lives campaign, in that scenario, this death rate started coming down, and now it is 1% or close to 1%. Mission Zero, this also, we have adopted this mission in the various slum-dominated population, like in Dharavi. Now, even today also, we are getting zero cases in Dharavi or most of the slum areas. The major concern about the pregnant women and the dialysis patient, the patient who are in need of dialysis facility, during the first wave, we used to get a tremendous call about the where to admit the COVID-positive mother for delivering a child. And similarly, similar was the fate of the dialysis patient. But we launched the two different interventional program for pregnant women, COVID-positive pregnant women. We have created a separate facility like in Nayar Hospital. Till date, we could, facilitate 1,400 deliveries and minimal MMR, maternal mortality rate, or IFR, infant mortality rate, IMR. Same is the case with dialysis. We have created Project Victory for dialysis patients, and they are getting dialysis at the appropriate time without any problem now. Because there are the 10 pillars of the Mumbai model, because the Mumbai model is talked about across India or appreciated everywhere. Yeah, now we are also getting ready for the third wave. It has been predicted that, yes, the third wave would hit us in the month of September or October. But we are getting ready to take on n number of cases, even if the cases goes up, the cases load goes up, like strengthening surveillance or spot tracking or genome sequencing. It has also been made us understand that pediatrics, the kids would be more affected. So therefore, we have constituted a pediatric task force to advise us how to manage the patients. I would elaborate in the subsequent slide. Capacity building, also we have come up with the SOPs for the pediatric surge. We are also developing the new jumbo facilities, appointing human resources for managing the surge of cases, setting up additional oxygen plants for providing the more oxygen to the patient, adequate oxygen to the patient, aggressive vaccination, and the prevention of super severe events. All these things are we have targeted, and definitely we can take on the third wave. Like strengthening our ongoing surveillance, we are following the same 4T model, and we are tracking, testing, treating the patients, and also keeping tab on the super spreaders, like the places having more footfall. There we are also testing them so that they can be taken out from the citizens, and they can be isolated so that further spread can be checked. COVID testing, again, RT-PCR, we are relying heavily on RT-PCR. As ICMR directed us, we are trying to keep 70% RT-PCR ratio to RAT, because RAT we are using as a screening module, but RT-PCR is the gold standard test, and we are relying heavily on that. Maximum contact, we are screen and testing by the fifth day, so that after fifth or sixth day, as advised to us by the task force, that the patient may get symptomatic and he may test positive. So we are following that norm. Maximum testing, we have opened 244 testing centers across Mumbai. Then you can walk and get yourself tested without charging, without paying anything. We are also organizing various testing camps at the crowded places like railway stations, market, airports, at various places. Genome sequencing, yes, I mean, we are relying heavily for the third wave on the genome sequencing. As of now, we are collecting samples of the international travelers and from the community and sending it to NIV Pune for getting the results, for getting it done. But the turnaround time is more than a month. So therefore, our interventions may hamper or the effective implementation may not take place. Therefore, we have decided to have our own genome sequencing laboratory. And hopefully by this month end, it would be operational because we are awaiting the shipping of that machine. In a couple of days, that machine would be available. On that basis, we can really figure out our treatment protocol, our management of the patient, and our infrastructure augmentation in case of need. The pediatric transpose, as I said, when it was indicated that yes, the kids and the slum population would be more in number during the third wave. So government of Maharashtra has decided to set up a pediatric task force for providing guidance on the preventive measures and treatment of COVID infection in children. We also have taken their support for training and for training our own doctors and for the general practitioners, the all pediatricians, private pediatricians working in the nursing homes or practicing individually, so that the treatment protocol, the management protocol, the referral protocol should be at the same level, on the same page. All of us would be on the same page, and there won't be any miscommunication or misguidance, so that overall fear level of the larger audience would be reduced. And we also have taken multiple training to all categories, like ASHA workers or Anganwadi workers or the medical officers, so that everyone, if it is trained properly, so there won't be any issue for admitting them, for treating them, and for managing them. The infrastructure augmentation, we have decided to continue with the existing jumbo facilities, though the life is over, but I mean, we have retrofitted them, we have repaired them wherever necessary. Now all our earlier six jumbo centers are ready to admit patients, but we have decided to create four more facilities having more than 8,500 beds. Out of these 70% beds, close to 6,000 beds would be having the oxygen supply system, 1,000 pediatric beds would be there, and 1,500 ICU beds would be there, the critical patients from all categories, from all age groups. We also have decided to set up a special COVID bed capacity at NESCO. NESCO, again, it is a makeshift arrangement. It is one of the jumbo facility, and it is still working without any problem. And we have decided to set up a separate pediatric COVID ward, so that the parent along with the kids, if the both are positive, they can share the that ward. If the parent is negative and kid is positive, then at appropriate distance, proper separation, we are trying to maintain, so that the cross infection should be avoided. And the parent also can keep watch on his kid and can provide support as and when required. Maternity homes, we are also equipping the maternity homes for admitting children, COVID positive children, and other facilities also, like major hospitals. We have four major hospitals like Sion, Nair, KEM, and Cooper. There also we have created separate pediatric ward having NICU and PICU facility, because NICU is not possible in the makeshift arrangement like jumbo facilities. Therefore, the NICU facility would be there either in the peripheral hospitals and in the major hospitals. For so far as the manpower requirements concerned, we are trying to outsource some of the facilities, so the shortage of manpower can be taken care of and appropriate intervention or appropriate treatment can be provided. And we have done the detailed micro planning of the pediatric case management, so that the overall fear level should not be there and proper care can be taken. One more thing I would like to add, we also have conducted a sero survey in the last month, and the results are very surprising and very encouraging as well. 51% or more than 51% children from across Mumbai have got the antibodies, positive antibodies, that means they would be somewhat secure from the infection of COVID-19 in the coming time.
Sir, actually, on that particular note, since you're talking about pediatric facilities, Mr. Vinod Kumar Menon has a couple of questions to ask. Over to you, Mr. Menon.
What are the arrangements that we have done at ground level in terms of getting the bed at the right time? Because we had seen in the first, second wave that people did have some kind of difficulty, though there was a helpline number provided, but the help was not reaching out on time. So I want to know which are the hospitals that we have tied up with other than the four BMC major hospitals that you just mentioned about. Have you also roped in any private hospitals? And if yes, what is the slab rate for where the parents will have to shell out money? And also, what happens to the immunocompressant children who are suffering either from cancer or any, they are having other health-related problems like HIV or anything? What are the measures that we have taken to ensure that even the care goes beyond the regular normal child who may be affected with COVID or the Delta 3? And the last one is, post-COVID, we have also seen, like Janmit was mentioning about his own experience about his child suffering from MIS, the multi-inflammatory syndrome. So how are we going to monitor these kids once they leave your jumbo center or the hospital that they do not get infected or affected by MIS after two to three months time duration? So if you can answer those points.
So far as the admitting patients are concerned, we have the ward war room. Those will be functional 24/7. And this, all these ward rooms, including the central control room, having the 1916 as a toll-free number, to guide the parents where to admit, how to admit, and what should be the treatment protocol or the testing protocol is concerned. These facilities would be manned by the medical practitioner, including the pediatrician. So he would be capable enough, the pediatrician is capable enough, stationed in the ward room or the central ward room, to advise the people, number one. This time we have imparted training to the all pediatricians practicing either in the smaller nursing homes or in individual consultation rooms, so that they can also advise the parents of the probable patient, I would say, that what treatment should be there, how to manage this patient, these kids, and when to test these kids and how to test it, and where the facilities are available. So we have conducted 5 rounds of training, and practically each and every pediatrician working in this field, working in Mumbai, are better trained. This is number two. Number three, some of the private hospitals like HRCC, that has also set up a pediatric COVID pediatric ward. The Wadia Hospital, Wadia Children Hospital, which is in Parel area, next to KEM Hospital, also came up with the setting up of the COVID pediatric ward. The major hospitals, like as I said, all major hospitals like Sion, KEM, Nair Cooper, NICU, ICU, ICU, all the normal oxygenated bed would be available for admitting positive kids for better treatment. The peripherals, we have 16 peripheral hospitals, out of 16, 13 peripheral hospitals, because some of the peripheral hospitals we are reserving it for non-COVID illnesses or the monsoon-related illnesses, the 13 hospitals would be having at least 10 ICU beds or PICU beds or NICU beds for that matter for admitting COVID positive kids. Along with that, we are also sharing the ICU material, because as of now we are not sharing, because we are just waiting the third wave. It is not a waiting, we are getting ready for the third wave. At the appropriate time, we would spread a word through IC activities to the parents, so that the overall panic level would be reduced. And the fifth one, well, as I said, we have conducted the sero survey across Mumbai of the kids below 18 years of age, and 51% of the kids are now having antibodies. So all these factors are really acting as a confidence building, acting as a support system, so that there should not be any panic at any level. And of course, all of us, are available around the clock in case of any emergency, in case of any need, so that our intervention, because multi-inflammatory syndrome is also, may act as a spoil sport for us. So we are also targeting that, we are also focusing that. And our entire medical fraternity is also geared up to take on the third wave. We hope that it won't affect us, but we are preparing for the worst.
Thank you so much, sir, for your answer. Since we are talking about resources, I have a very important question for Mr. Amit Deshmukh. Mr. Deshmukh, Maharashtra Health Minister Rajesh Tope said that experts have warned that the impending third wave could be bigger than the second, with 60 lakh people getting infected. This could also push up the medical oxygen requirement from 2,000 MT to 4,000 MT, he had said. In the previous wave, there was a dearth of oxygen cylinders, among other resources. Have we learned from our mistakes and increased our oxygen capacity this time to protect our children, which is also the unvaccinated and most vulnerable age group currently in the pandemic?
Like you mentioned that our health minister has raised concern about the number of cases in the third wave going beyond the second wave. We must gear up considering that alert. That goes without saying. And yes, I think under the leadership of our dynamic Chief Minister Uddhav Thackerayji, this government has been working 24/7 as far as COVID is concerned. Like you know that, a little while ago, my administrative colleague, Mr. Suresh Kakani, also mentioned that the work that has been done in COVID in Mumbai especially has been noted world over. So, yes, we have emphasized on captive oxygen generation plants that each hospital must have, whether it is government or private. In fact, the health authorities are making it mandatory now for above a certain capacity hospital. I had suggested that 50 beds and above, all hospitals should have their own oxygen generating or generation plant. So, that will take care of a lot of oxygen requirement. We also have come out with a scheme for investors and industrialists that when they invest in oxygen manufacturing plants, we are giving them a whole lot of incentives. I mean, that's the policy that has been conceptualized by our Honorable Chief Minister Uddhav Thackerayji and Industries Minister Mr. Subhash Desaiji. We, as Medical Education Minister, I have given a lot of inputs and made sure that the requirement reaches the Industries Department. Mr. Tope also has assessed the requirement, and we have made it very clear what is the oxygen generation that is required in Maharashtra. Let's hope that we don't get to 60 lakh cases. I hope that the third wave is much milder than the second wave. But we must also not forget that this is a pandemic and under epidemic, everything actually then is taken over by the government of India. We also very well know that whether, injections, medicines, oxygen, all this was then, because this is international pandemic. So we have to work very closely. We have to make Maharashtra self-reliant in terms of oxygen. I think if we have, captive oxygen plants, a lot of issues will be resolved. And the key is, not to transport oxygen. That's what was very challenging in the first and the second wave. I think we've learned our lesson. And that is why we are emphasizing on captive oxygen generation plants. And, I would just appeal once again that being safe, letting the virus not contract you is the key. Wear your mask, physical distance, get vaccinated. This is the key. I think if we follow that, we might even sort of not get into the third wave. Who knows? So that's the target.
Thank you, Mr. Deshmukh. A quick another question for you. Do you think then it is time to open schools in India? It's been almost 18 months. I'm asking you this because kids are sufficiently sensitized to COVID protocol now, and it has been proven that their increased immunity helps them fight the virus better. So are schools and colleges going to open soon?
The schools are opening worldwide, and in India, in Maharashtra, I think we must be the first ones to get our children back into the schools. I think in the state, like we have sort of planned, you know, we have several levels of this pandemic. I think the cities, you know, maybe in level one, if everybody, all stakeholders in the school, whether it is teachers, you know, support staff, transporters, you know, if they are 100% vaccinated, and I think they maintain a chain, they take parents into confidence. I think what is the key is that you have to maintain a COVID appropriate bubble or a chain. So that is, I mean, the schools that qualify that criteria, I think they should be allowed to open because academically, I think students are losing out. What I mean is the outdoor physical activity, co-curricular, you know, 8 hours in front of the screen is also very challenging for the children. I'm quite confident that Mumbai or Maharashtra will be the first state to lay example to get back our students back into schools and colleges. We are working on that.
Okay. Thank you so much, sir. Let's hope that comes true. We will now take some questions from other panelists for Mr. Kakani and Mr. Deshmukh before they exit.
I have a question there. Thank you so much, sir. Again, going back to my experience. So, in fact, when me and my family were struggling with COVID, thank you so much. I mean, the type of support which was extended by BMC was commendable. In fact, we were getting a personal call from the BMC doctor every day to check on our health. And that was very assuring. Sir, just a request. In fact, at that point of time, what we figured out that, as I already said, that we were aware about how to deal with COVID, but how to deal with something which comes post-COVID is something we were not aware of. So, sir, have we come up with any mechanism wherein, like, when people recover, and large part of the population recovers at home, as what I can understand as of now, and some people, like, you know, they definitely land up to hospitals. So, for this proportion of this population who recovers from COVID, is there a proactive approach wherein we get in touch with these people and tell them actively that yes, there can be a post-COVID complication and these are the triggers, and if this happens, you must, you know, reach out to the doctor immediately? So that's my question, sir.
Yes, I think you know, we have a very proactive approach as far as post-COVID care is concerned. We have post-COVID OPDs, you know, for patients who've had COVID and who are recovering. And if they have any other complications, they can reach out to their OPD. The health department, the medical education department has their own SOPs, protocols. We have, you know, extended that across the state. We will now that you have, you know, reiterated this point, we will be more aggressive as far as this is concerned in the view of the third wave. I think all the corporations also, Mumbai also, I think has been very, very active and proactive as far as post-COVID care is concerned. Our Honorable Chief Minister Uddhav Thackerayji has had multiple Zoom meetings and webinars with you know, doctors across the state and across the city, which is Mumbai, the capital. I think me and all our colleagues will be more aggressive as far as post-COVID care is concerned.
I think Dr. Jacob has another question.
Not a question before Sri Deshmukh and Sri Kakani leave. I have two suggestions. You know, Maharashtra is well known for managerial planning and execution. In that line, I would like Maharashtra to do in every district a small, well-planned zero survey so that we will know that today everybody knows that Kolhapur, Mumbai, Sangli, Thane and Pune are the major population areas with the infection, but the rest of the districts, we need to know the ground level of immunity. So quick, small, well-designed sero survey will help us, especially when we are moving into school reopening phase. The second suggestion I have is that, unfortunately, in spite of Pune being within Maharashtra, you have a vaccine inadequacy. We can quickly assess if the first dose recipients, if they can get half a dose, that is splitting the second dose into two people, so you can double the number of second dose recipients. Just 30 people you give, then measure their virus neutralizing antibody. And if that is comparable to the full dose, then you have now, you can do two dose straight away. So that is something that we should do. And if that requires a central government approval, we can get that quickly, ICMR or something like that. For the Covaxin, there is a potential even giving fractional intradermal dose like we do for IPV, inactivated poliovirus vaccine, only for the second dose, not for the first dose. The first dose recipients, fractional intradermal Covaxin. So you can get five vaccinations out of one vial. This can be done within 2 weeks. In other words, the day when you give, you have a pre-blood, 2 weeks later, you have a post-blood, measure the virus neutralizing antibody. And if they are reasonably good, we have built-in mechanism to extend the available vaccines usage and cover more people. Thank you very much.
Thank you so much, Doctor. I hope these suggestions are taken into consideration.
Thank you, Mr. Jacob, because very good suggestions you have made for conducting the sero survey. So far as Mumbai is concerned, we already have conducted sero survey for the kids having age less than 18, and we have got the very fantastic results. 51% or more kids have got the antibodies developed. We are also planning the major sero survey commencing in a week's time, or because we are from 15th of July, we have started our preparations for conducting it across Mumbai in across 24 wards, and the sample size would be more than 6,000 or close to 10,000 persons if it is really possible. And that will also help us to understand the overall health status and overall condition of the patients. So for the second is concerned, definitely we can place it before the ICMR, because who is advising Government of India of what should be the gap between the two doses, what should be the quantity of each dose. So certainly your suggestions would be placed before the ICMR, and because it is being governed centrally, we can't really initiate at our level without getting a nod, formal nod from ICMR or Government of India. But yes, in case they are on page, they are on board, definitely we'll take it forward. Thank you very much.
Thank you so much, Mr. Kakani. Thank you, Mr. Deshmukh. It was a pleasure talking to you today.
Thank you very much. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Thank you very much for inviting us. Thank you very much.
Our next question is for Dr. Shakuntala Prabhu, which Somita Pal would like to ask.
We would like to know, how is Wadia Hospital prepared to tackle the third wave? How many COVID beds, ICU beds, ventilators, and oxygen cylinders would be made available at the time of crisis, if the crisis hits the pediatric group? Would parents be allowed inside the facility during the recovery period? And does the hospital have a list of resources they will need to acquire from the government? How many pediatric emergency ambulances do you have right now plying in the city? And how many critical kits can this fleet cater to in a day?
We have to be prevent the third wave and not panic. And that is what our motto is. And as Honorable Chief Minister has taken the lead and, you know, started the pediatric task force, and MCGM is supporting We at the Wadia Children's Hospital, from 22 COVID care beds, we have now made plans, have the infrastructure, resources, and manpower to increase it to 200 beds, of which almost 70 beds are critical care beds, which we can for both the pediatric, that is children and neonates. So we have the capability, and with the support of the MCGM, we will be able to take around 200 children who would need COVID care. As we said, as was already discussed here, children with comorbidities have to continue their care, and we have facilities for all the comorbid children who may be critical, and we can definitely take care of them. As was told by the parent, MISC, which is also a post-COVID illness that we see in these children, we have given the education to most of our pediatricians and told that, these post-COVID illness, the red eyes, red mouth and skin rash with persistent fever, and any of the gastrointestinal or any obtuse symptoms, they need to see their pediatricians early, and these children need to be coming to the healthcare facility for early and timely management. So this post-COVID illness, as told by Mr. Singh, the parent, is very important that we recognize these early, and we have made all these arrangements. In fact, we have a post-COVID OPD also running in the hospital. And with your second, we have as arrangements, we have the RT-PCR, the turnover time at the in-house diagnostic facility that we have is less than 5 hours. And we also have the rapid antigen testing. So all children who are very critically ill, we also do the RAT, and we can diagnose them early. All these, of course, is we have the whole support of the MCGM. We are also encouraging flu shots for children who are high risk, children who have comorbidity. It is better that they be given the flu shots. And also we are encouraging all parents who have taken at least one dose or no dose to go in for the COVID vaccination. It is important, as the third wave is now on the list, it is better these parents are vaccinated. So that was your first. The second was, you said the parents. Yeah, we would be allowing at least one parent, usually the mother, to be with the child. So it is easier to manage these children in the COVID ward. You did ask about ambulances. Yeah, we have one cardiac ambulance for inter-hospital transfers and this. But I am sure the Mumbai city has 108 ambulances. And this, which can cater to most of these critical care children. So it is possible. And the war rooms that are there, the communication channels that have been open, it is easier to transfer these children in a very coordinated, continued care manner.
Great. Thank you, Dr. Prabhu. Moving to our next question, it's for Dr. Jacob John. Doctor, there is a growing concern about MISC post-COVID. We've also been discussing about it in this session. If the third wave was to hit Mumbai before a vaccine arrives for children, what are the many complications that they will face this time? This is also a question from our reader, Mr. Romal Kothari.
There are two, three things that we should look at. First of all, it's very good to be alerted and prepare for facing a third wave, whether or not the third wave actually comes. So therefore, fear is not what we need now. Cold-blooded planning is what we need now, and that is what Maharashtra seems to be doing. Are children more vulnerable? Were they more vulnerable in the second wave? Will they be in case a third wave comes? All information shows no. About 5 to 6% of COVID in the community are borne by children. That includes this multi-system inflammatory disease. That was true in the first wave. It's true in the second wave also. So the rapid increase in the number of cases in the whole population, reflected by that huge pyramid-like or tower-like graph of the second wave, was reflected with about 5 to 6% children also affected. So therefore, it is a proportionate representation of children rather than an absolute increased risk of children for these complications. We must be prepared for post-COVID presentation of this multi-system inflammatory. Everybody knows that. And fortunately, Indian Academy of Pediatrics is based in Mumbai, and you can get their cooperation and help in making all pediatricians aware of what to look for. Early diagnosis is very important, because early diagnosis will lead to better treatment and life-saving support. In global literature, death rate of treated MICs are 1%, less than 2%. So we need not fear as to what's going to happen, but be prepared. Now, my final question, what's the likelihood of third wave? You can look at it two ways, all India data or Maharashtra data. If you look at all India data, our second wave has coincided with the South African third wave, UK fourth wave, and the current wave in Indonesia, all of them led by Delta variant. Ours also, more than 80% of our second wave was Delta variant. So Delta variant has come and gone everywhere. This is not the time to predict a third wave, because the number of people already infected, leaving behind who are uninfected, in India, it is less than 400 million out of 1,400 million population. There are many ways of calculating that. They all agree on that number, less than 400, distributed throughout the country, a little more skewed towards rural areas. That is not sufficient for a wave, unless a new variant with far higher infection efficiency than Delta appears. So what Maharashtra is doing in terms of genomic surveillance, the country is also doing genomic surveillance, but we are not doing it enough. We missed the onslaught of the Delta very early on. People didn't pay much attention to the Delta variant, although it was known from December of 2020. It took off in March. And of course, it is from here that UK got their Delta variant, and probably from there it multiplied all over the world. So the likelihood of Maharashtra having a third wave, India, I said, is quite unlikely because of the available information. We need to know what proportion of people are yet uninfected in Mumbai, in Maharashtra. I don't think it can be more than 50 million. Your population is about 112, 113 million. The interesting thing is, even children, their antibody survey results show that they have been almost equally infected, like adolescents and young adults. So altogether, Maharashtra also looks like a picture of all India. Since June 14, Maharashtra levels of new reported cases have not crossed 10,000. It's a fairly steady. So the effective reproduction number is around 1 and stable. So Maharashtra is in an endemic phase of our infection. Maharashtra has 2 million babies born every year. So if 2 million babies get infected every year, that is a potential maximum you can get infected, of which only about 2 to 5% can have clinical COVID. So you can, overall the picture is that I don't think there will be a major wave, anything like the second wave. If at all it comes, it'll be much lower in its maximum height. I would call it a ripple in the curve of the infection. Yet, there may be a third wave or a wave coming at the third time of concentrated diseases that we have neglected so far.
Correct.
Diphtheria, measles, whooping cough, so many other things, even tuberculosis. So we have to be watchful for that. And whatever infrastructure we create now should be utilized for any rise in the incident prevalence of diseases other than COVID that you should legitimately expect. Maharashtra has a reputation of Aikave Janachi, Karave Manachi. The Janachi are experts like me and the central government in Delhi. Listen to them, but decide for Maharashtra yourself. Thank you very much.
Thank you so much, Dr. Jacob. Our next question is for Dr. Hira. Mr. Vinod Kumar Menon would like to ask.
This question is for you from one of the reader, Navita Kurup. So her question is basically about children aged 2 to 6 years participating in clinical trials for Covaxin will likely be administered the second dose of Bharat Biotech sometime early next week. That's what is being said. With the emergence of Delta plus variant that is feared in a few countries and its threat looming India, they anticipate that 150 children, which we have, right? How do you think India has feared in terms of vaccine development? Do you think our country was slow in conducting vaccines for the trial run for the pediatric group? And do we know the efficacy of these vaccines? And also important is like the immunology part of it, where like we missed out on polio vaccine, the other vaccines which had to be given for the newborns within the first 9 months. But that also got missed out. As Dr. Jacob John has correctly pointed out, we have to be prepared for the other diseases which can or which we might have ignored. What you would like to say?
Thank you, Mr. Menon. Congratulations to Midday and your media group for taking this leadership and bringing the leadership as well as a technical scientists together, the implementers. Your questions have two or three parts, and I'm very glad to be with you here today. I'm an infectious disease doctor with a strong background of epidemiology and training and with the United Nations in different capacities. Very clear message that I want to give through you to our constituents in India is that India has done remarkably well in terms of developing the vaccines. India as such, in terms of the childhood vaccines and their production, has been the hub of vaccines for childhood diseases for the whole world. So to say that India already had a good background or a good base for good vaccines, standard vaccines, that is undeniable. Apart from saying that the same thing is true about the pharmacies and the pharmaceuticals. But at the same time, to say that whether India, in terms of its policies, did it actually begin with the vaccine trials? Because you have to, when there's a new vaccine, you have to do good trials. And good trials are supposed to be phase 3 trials with placebos. There was a huge push at some point in globally that the people talked that let's not wait for long placebo controlled trials. Let's go for quick, dirty job and see if they are safe and good and go into injecting vaccines. And India said no, and a lot of countries said no. So India went very well with adult vaccines, which was the right way to do, because first of all, the most vulnerable in this were the 60 plus group. So India went in, now it is in the big implementation phase that I know. There are more than 30 crore adults in India who are already vaccinated. And the question now is there's a big group that is the children that you're very rightly focused today. They are all not vaccinated yet. A lot of them possibly are infected, but they are positive on antibody. Just a word of caution here from immunology that I know and I have worked on is that just to say 51% of Mumbai children in this study that Mr. Kakani very rightly pointed out, it's a good study. But at the same time, how much can we rely on that 51% positive antibodies? Because the antibodies here are non-specific antibodies, although they are tested for COVID, and out of which how many actually are neutralizing the COVID virus is still unknown. We don't know which neutralizing antibodies actually provide protection against COVID. So with that caution, my request to the leadership of Maharashtra is that be known that there are a lot of children are 51% COVID antibody positive, but all of them may not be necessarily protected by COVID as it is coming. So that is one answer. The second is that Covaxin, which is one of the India's pride along with Covishield, that we have been able to, with lightning speed, I would call it, that vaccine has already been developed and delivered to adults and going on. In terms of children, they are doing a clinical trial in 6 hospitals in India with 500 children in 3 children groups. Children are 35% of India's population. 46 crore are children and adolescents in India out of 140 crores. So we are talking of a very large proportion of our future, which is not yet protected, but you cannot go and inject them without doing a good clinical trial for its safety, whether it's these are producing any protection, and then the efficiency. But what is already shown that these vaccines are effective and they protect the adults. So there cannot be a vaccine who only protects adults and cannot protect the children. So you need to go for a small study, which very rightly Covaxin is doing on 500 children in India at 6 hospitals, which comprises of 4 to 6 years, 6 to 12 years, and 12 to 18 years. And this study is already down by 6 weeks. We know that what was just suggested, that we should look at different doses in terms of dilution of these vaccines. Those are already included in the design. The nasal versus the injectable is also included in the design, because when you get these results by January 2022 for all these 3 groups, that will also provide information on whether the injectable vaccine was equally good as the nasal spray vaccine. It's a vaccine which will be in a small bottle and you pump it into the nostrils and that's it. No needle, no injection to children, and then can go also to adults. I think we are going to a very, very exciting stage at this point. And so I suggest that we keep a very positive attitude towards what's happening. These vaccines in children obviously will be, once if the report results come out pretty good in January, and I don't doubt whether there will be something which will stop the process on the way. But to be delivered, it will take another 3 to 4 months for these to be delivered. So I think a reasonable timetable is April to June of 2022, when our children start reasonably vaccinated. And that's the time I think they will be safe to go to school. Although some adults or adolescents in 12 to 18, they are appearing to, in some studies of Pfizer and Moderna, the American groups are showing good. So I think the task force can make decisions accordingly. It's not a hopeless situation. I think it's a country such large and has done so extremely well, So we should all, as scientists, be proud of what is happening in India with pandemics. Thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Hira. Mr. Menon, do you have another question for Dr. Hira?
Yeah, Pruta. So, Dr. Hira, this is something that we have been bothered about, the sickle cell disease that is very predominantly seen in tribal children from Maharashtra, Chhattisgarh, or Gujarat, and for that matter, even the Northeast. Now, especially sickle cell disease, we also know the kind of respiratory infection that it can lead to, or even the joint pain. Just want to check out, like, you know, how do you look upon the morbidity present as a separate challenge when it comes to vaccine trial for these tribal kids? Because metros, we know that, like, you know, we are well equipped, but when it comes to medical infrastructure in the rural area or tribal belt of India, we are not that well equipped even today. So your view on that?
That's one of the smartest questions I've heard in decades, because nobody comes up with these questions about looking at tribal health, the people in the tribal districts in Maharashtra, Gujarat, Dang district, you have Orissa, you have Chhattisgarh, and you have such large tribal population who have genetic diseases. So what you named out was sickle cell disease, is a gene-related disease, comes from the genes of the parents when the child is being formed in a womb. And to really pay attention to this, I think to call the process as special need children, they are not only the sickle cell, but they are also those who have thalassemias. They again have genetic diseases. They would have symptoms almost like what you just described, can have lung disease or difficulty with urines and joint swellings and all. And they have shown, some studies I saw, have shown 6 times higher death rate of COVID in sickle cell disease children. The same thing will go with thalassemia. The same thing will go with diabetes type 1 children. So I think very true that government of Maharashtra and other states, they always have very special programs for tribal health and special districts like Nandurbar. You have Chandrapur, you have Nagpur areas. Those areas have, I think, not less than 8,000 to 10,000 children who have sickle cell disease, and they are all in a registry. So I think it will be very easy for government to wake up now, get going. You still have a month. Now, whether the third wave is going to be big peak or small peak, it is coming. I mean, this is no horoscope about it. It is the scientific epidemiology that third wave is coming by, say, mid-August or September. There will be the similar challenges and dissimilar challenges like wave two. And the better part is that be prepared for such eventuality that we all feel that we are not guilty of having let the opportunity of good health slip by in India.
My next question is again for you, Dr. Jacob, since we were talking about waves earlier. The COVID data reveals that the second wave was more serious than the first one in India, especially in 2 states, Kerala and Maharashtra. How would you suggest we improve the statistics in these 2 states?
All states in India are, each one is different from the other. In many ways, Kerala, Maharashtra have some similarities, but the population density, for example, climatic conditions, the health management system. Maharashtra has some disadvantages in terms of the extremely crowded cities and slums, which is unusual for the rest of the country. Tribals are a bit more remote populations in terms of social mixing. Having taken those into account, is there evidence to say that Maharashtra and Kerala had a worse deal than other states? I don't believe so. Because if you calculate as per million population statistics, I don't see these states are worse off. Kerala has a certain disadvantage now, because in the very beginning, they flattened the curve very, very effectively. And subsequently, they had an exodus of the diaspora returning by plane loads on a daily basis and bringing infection from various countries, particularly the Middle East. If you recall, last March, it was a tourist family coming back from Dubai that brought infection to Pune, and then it began spreading. So you can imagine that happening hundreds of times every week in Kerala. With all that, Kerala managed reasonably well. If you look at the hospitalization and mortality rates, Kerala is probably doing much better than even Tamil Nadu, almost every other state. So I'm not skeptical in terms of what's going to happen in both these states. Kerala is a high plateau today. Maharashtra is a low plateau today. But unless you assemble the entire experience of coronavirus infection, you will not be able to make an assessment as to whether vulnerability of Kerala and Maharashtra is any more than anywhere else in the country. I want to add one more thing. The antibody surveys necessarily are not virus neutralizing antibody surveys, because it's not practical to do it. However, the binding antibody that almost all antibody tests measure has very high specificity of immune response to the SARS coronavirus. Moreover, the major weakness of the antibody survey is that it underestimates the true immunity level. Third sero survey of ICMR very clearly showed that of people who had recorded RT-PCR positive coronavirus, only 63.6% of them were positive in the antibody survey. So you have to actually calculate 50 divided by 63.6 multiplied by 100. So you can imagine it's far higher than the 51% actually shows. So all in all, it's very good to be alert and prepared for any eventuality. Be prepared for the worst, even when you expect the best. So it is good to be alert and be preparing for a possible onslaught of a third wave. The most important step in that is to keep a watch on variants.
Mm-hmm.
Unless a variant with an R0 value of delta is about 4 to 6, unless it is more than 4 to 6, and R0 cannot be measured in animal experiments. It has been measured in humans. So quick follow-up of any new variant of interest, investigation, and concern, and to see whether it is spreading fast in the community. That will be the signal of a third wave. Vinod Kumar Menon asked a question earlier, what about immunity due to vaccination will it protect against Delta? A lot of studies globally have gone on, and all studies show that if you have fairly high antibody level, you are well protected against severe COVID across the age. So all decent vaccines, I'm saying it because starting with the messenger RNA vaccines, and the vector vaccines and the inactivated vaccine with adjuvant, not without adjuvant, not the Chinese vaccines with only aluminum adjuvant, with the Covaxin has an advantage of having an alhydroxyquim adjuvant. All of them have good immune response against, or can be measured against, even Delta variant and all the other variants, with one or two exceptions, especially the South African variant and one particular vaccine.
Okay.
So all these need to be checked continuously, and that is ICMR's job. Maharashtra should push the INSACOG and ICMR for information, okay, so that we keep alerted of the earliest signal. But in terms of what we can expect today, we need not be too anxious about a third wave.
I actually wanted to add to my question, since we were talking about variants. Now, these variants have sort of changed, evolved from Delta plus, Lambda, Kappa in the last few months in India. Where and when do you think these mutations will stop? At what point would they stop?
That is even a smarter question than the one that Vinod Kumar asked. What do we use as a model in the past? I have looked at many, many diseases and come to the conclusion that measles is probably the best model. Influenza is not. It's a non-invasive infection and many other things. So measles became a human pathogen from bovines in the 11th or 12th century. It infected a whole lot of adults. And then eventually, as the last one century, it has come down to become a pediatric disease. What is the R0 of measles virus? 25 to 30. Beware, coronavirus can increase in R0 up to that level. So when we predict or when we anticipate the lack of or low probability of a third wave, we are assuming that we don't get a Delta, a variant more infectious than Delta. However, we should not let our guard down. We have to keep looking at variants. All the variants that you now suggested are not more infectious than Delta. Delta takes the cake. So far, of all the variants that we have seen, even the beyond Delta variations, none of them match infectivity with Delta. It can go up to R0 of 30. We should anticipate that. Mm-hmm. Be prepared for that. Unless we eradicate COVID ahead of time.
Mm-hmm.
Okay? It's not beyond the realm of possibility to eradicate COVID. We have eradicated smallpox. Measles almost. Two continents of North and South America, it was eliminated, but it keeps coming back. That's a lesson for COVID also. Unless you do everything globally well, you cannot expect any disease to be eradicated.
Thank you, Dr. Jacob. My next question is for Soumitra. Soumitra, Dr. Prabhu very rightly mentioned when she was talking about the kind of arrangements that are being done at Wadia Hospital that if the parent can reach to a helpline number and get the help that they need, getting a treatment is much quicker. She's right in saying that. Now, in a time of crisis, first respondents are usually the men manning helpline numbers, right? Desperate and worried parents may want to know whom or where to reach out to get their kids admitted in hospitals, or maybe even to get leads for beds in the closest pediatric care facility. As a special correspondent who has been covering detailed health stories in the pandemic, you have witnessed the city's health infrastructure falling apart in the second wave. In this context, how well equipped do you think our first respondent should be to offer valid information to parents of sick children?
Thanks, Pritha. When it comes to parents, I think the first respondents are two people. One is the family doctor or the pediatrician, and the other is the helpline number. Now, if you see, if we compare the first wave and second wave, I think this time BMC and pediatricians, that we are better prepared for the third wave. BMC has this war rooms, which is manned 24/7 by the medical practitioners. And it's like per ward, there is one war room helpline number. They have tied up with the private practitioners. Also this time, they have given the training to them on how to give a proper treatment, proper management, what will be the protocol. And also we have this state pediatric task force, which has members from the Indian Academy of Pediatricians. They have been having this training module for the healthcare workers on how to pick up the red flags. And when a parent gets in touch with them with the symptoms, etc., to pick up those signs and whether the child will require a home management or has to be shifted to a private or a public setup, they can accordingly guide them. So I think this time the government, the helpline, the first respondents are a little bit much prepared than what it was in the second week.
Thank you, Soumitra. Let's move to our concluding question now. My question is for all three of you, Dr. Jacob, Dr. Hira, and Dr. Prabhu. Is it necessary to continue vaccinating people despite not having any guaranteed protection? Or is there a guaranteed protection if a person does get vaccinated? What is your advice to Mumbai or India? And when do you see this pandemic coming to an end?
I think it's a very provocative question. No doubt now that these vaccines of any manufacturer with the good clinical trials already done have evidence, scientific evidence, that these vaccines are protective. These are protective almost to the similar level by most of them. There might be a difference of 1 or 2 or 5% here and there, but all of them are protective against hospitalization. They're protective against death. I want to add one point that about variants. You were asking what will happen with variants over time, and there already are ominous signs happening in some countries where I'm aware of the scientific research that we talked about alpha, beta, gamma, delta. These are four important variants which are aggressively now infecting, causing the second wave, for example, is Delta. Now, the Alpha and Delta are being combined together in some new patients in the UK. So what is happening is that these variants are now putting their forces together. And what happens if Alpha and Beta together, the way they are causing much severe illness and hospitalization, if that comes in much faster spread with more travel and opening up of sort of social systems in the UK, people are raising alarms since the last week. So be alert that this war is an interlude with the vaccines. The story is is still left. A longer story is still yet to come.
Yes, Janmeet, would you like to add?
Seeing so many eminent doctors here, I can't stop myself from asking a question, please. So my question is, we have been talking about MISC post-COVID. So number one, apart from MISC, you know, are there any other complications which kids face? The second thing is, once the kid recovers from a COVID, till how much time is that child really vulnerable to an occurrence of a post-COVID complication? So as a parent, how much time should be people, you know, be taking, really be, you know, be on top of things, and they really should monitor their kids that there is no post-COVID complication coming in?
So post-COVID, we see these illness somewhere from 3 weeks to 3 months usually, but we can go up to 6 months. After that, usually the post-COVID illness doesn't happen. But yeah, I mean, we have started a post-COVID OPD, and I think it is important for at least a year to monitor these patients, as it is told that in children, they have very mild illness, and but they can have subclinical infection, but may have complications. So we are following up most of these children But there are, as already said, red flags. And I think, as Mr. Singh did say, we have the protocols, we have the red flags. And I think all pediatricians and even parents are being made aware now how to recognize these the children and the symptoms and take timely help from the healthcare facilities. It is important, as you said, the comorbid factors, when they are there, these children have more complications. Otherwise, usually the infection is very mild.
Mr. Menon, would you like to add your thoughts to this session that we had today?
It's an interesting session to have eminent experts like Dr. Jacob John, Dr. Subhash Hira, who has worked very closely as far as Ebola and the world experience, what they carry. But yeah, amid this COVID, the concern is equally about information and disinformation. That is where my concern comes in.
Yeah.
Because the whole of the social media is flooded with information. Now, how do a common man who has the world on his tip of his finger, he gets that information? But whether he knows that information is actually information or it is a disinformation. For instance, put lemon juice inside your nostril, the virus will die. Or you have HCQ added to your lemonade. And for HCQ, believe me, the US former President Trump was also interested, and he was saying HCQ is the game changer. Now, today you realize WHO also has taken this very seriously, the information and the disinformation. And world over, they have now pointed out there are fact checkers who find that nearly 65% of the content on social media is nothing but disinformation. Now, that is where the question comes in. If you see, Reuters Institute in the Oxford University have come up with their own fact checkers who collect data across the globe, and they come up with a lot of information which turn out to be just nothing but a fake news. Okay. As far as India is concerned, amidst few news channels, unlike the Western countries where you have the fact checkers inside each newsroom, as far as government is concerned, we very honestly don't have a particular agency from where the information is coming in. You don't have one particular site where you can go look out for specific data or specific information, whether this is true, whether this is false, and how you're making the common man understand. So biggest challenge is that. And I think there will be waves, there will be new pandemics that we all will have to face at some point in the time. But how informations have to be neutralized, filtered before it reaches out to the end user, because that is a dangerous trend. Unless you filter, unless the correct information reach out to right people, like Janmeet, if he would have known the pros and cons of MIS when his child had COVID, if there would have been a bit of screening telling him this could be the complication of MIS, believe me, he would not have had this many doubts what he had. So it's a well experience. We all have to come together, plan out, discuss, use such platforms to spread in the right information so the person at the ground level understand all about COVID and is not disinformed about COVID. Thank you.
That's a very important point. Thank you, Mr. Menon. Yes, Dr. Jacob.
I grew up in a family with agriculture. If you don't tend to the field for 1 year, next year, it will be full of weeds. It's very difficult to cultivate a crop. And for weeds, you don't need anything. That's exactly what is happening with the mis- and disinformation spreading around. Now, we are a Eastern culture, Western culture. There are some differences. We look up to our leaders, listen to them, and by and large believe what they tell you with a straight face. In the West, they are quite skeptical of whatever anybody says. Look at Singapore, Thailand, Vietnam, South Korea, Taiwan. They have educated their people, and so they have had less problem with misinformation, disinformation. We have not learned that trick of the government taking the bull by the horn in terms of information, communication, and education of people, behavior modification, education. And in the absence of that, which I think was, we don't have a track record of doing that. Even for polio, we went to Amitabh Bachchan to tell people. So we don't have the track record, and we need to create one. And in this vacuum, who stood out prominently giving correct information? Print media. By and large, print media printed only reasonably reliable information. It is the social media with no curb that came up with all sorts of weird answers or information about COVID. So for future, India needs to prepare a methodology by which information will be filtered at the governmental level, top level, packaged into what people will understand, and given it repeatedly, the same message repeatedly. And when a new message comes in, add that to the old message. So a cacophony of messages, you know, contradicting what we said last week, this week, and then changing, and one person says something, another person says something else, even at the top level, that we have learned from experience is the wrong thing for us to do. There should be a system of giving out reliable information. Even then, some people may not believe. That you leave them aside. The vast majority of people will take if authentic information is given authoritatively from the right agency empowered for doing that particular job. So we need to create that in India.
Absolutely agree, Dr. Jacob. In fact, at midday, my colleagues and I, we believe in only reporting facts, and we will continue to do so. Thank you all so much for joining us today. Let's hope our city and the world can tide over. Thank you all for joining us today. Thanks a lot for your time.
Thank you. We will definitely win, this pandemic.
Thank you.
Subscribe to Midday India. Get direct notifications on all our videos by clicking on the bell icon.